Okay, hello everybody. My name is Gondi Heijerman. I'm from the Netherlands and I would like to tell you something about modern cultivation of raspberries. The content of the presentations is something first about Delphi, the company, and me myself. Afterwards, I will tell you something about raspberry propagation of the plants who we need to start the cultivation of raspberries, some information about using substrates, primocane, longcane varieties, also information about flowering and dormancy, water supply, and the nutrition is of course a very important part of the cultivation of raspberry out of soil, and at the end some information about pests and diseases. So as to start up Delphi, it's an advisory company. It's focused to give worldwide expertise for food and flowers. Important is the knowledge development and the knowledge implementation of new information throughout the whole world. And therefore, we have our own facilities to do research and focus on our own knowledge about the different kind of crops. And therefore, we have independent experts who give advice to the individual cultivation companies. So facts of Delphi, 225 employees, also in a lot of parts of the whole world. Only plant-related sectors we give information and advice, and it's mainly focused on training, research, and international development in plant-related sectors. So then something about myself. I started at Delphi at 2016, so by 4 years now. I'm working as senior soft foods researcher and advisory for soft foods at Delphi. Before I started at Delphi, I've been working at Wageningen University from 2000 to 2016, also involved in research into fruit. And then my specialty was variety testing. So then we will talk about raspberry fruits. Raspberry are composite fruits, individual fruits grown together into one fruit. The raspberries are often seen as small orange and red vitamin bombs. And for that reason, it's quite a lot of interest in eating, but also there's a lot of interest in cultivation and growing these fruits. They're not only healthy, but also very tasty, and therefore for consumers, very nice to eat. Here's some pictures, because in this presentation, we will mainly focus on substrate cultivation. There's a main reason that raspberry is not grown in the soil because of the main problems with root diseases. And therefore, to get the plants and cultivate them out of soil in pots, like you can see here at the pictures, it's a better and more higher quality and higher yields are possible to achieve. So if we compare raspberry substrate cultivation with cultivation in soil, then you can have a better disease management. The growth is better controllable. You have more efficiency and the harvest can be spread during the year by starting new cultivations on different times of the year. But to cultivate raspberry on substrate, it requires more knowledge. You have to be really reliable on your water supply, because as you can see at the picture, there are only small pots, and when they the plants don't get enough water, then they have a really big problem. So you the reliable water supply is very, very important. And you have to be aware that the investments to start up a cultivation in this way, it's really a higher investment. Start up a cultivation like this, it's important to start with really healthy plants. Otherwise, it's not possible to achieve high yields, which you really require to get earn back your investment. Over here, you can see the propagation of raspberry plants. It starts up with rootblocks, afterwards cuttings, and then you, in the propagation period, you make long cane plants. I will show you later on some different kind of pictures so you can see in which way this this works. In the Netherlands, the new cuttings and the new rootblocks start up in December in greenhouses in climate control atmosphere, so to achieve the best quality of cuttings. So first some pictures over here. You see the roots, which are used to make new rootblocks to where new plants will start up growing. Over here some other pictures of the new starting plants. Then after the new plants have started growing at the rootblocks, they will be separated into individual plants and will be growing further into individual cuttings with where the roots of the plants are the main most important part of the plants at that moment. When these cuttings will be transported to the nurseries, which will make a new plants of it in the nursery field. To start up over there with these plants, the roots need to be perfect to achieve a good startup of the new plants. So over here on the left side, you see the plants in the propagation field at the beginning of the season, and on the right side at the end of the season. The plants grow into at least 2-2.5 meters during one growing season. And also at that moment, the quality of the roots, that's the main important thing to start up a good production during the production phase. Here's some differences. On the left side, a plant which is not okay, as you can see. On the right side, the nice white roots, which are the main part of the plant to achieve high yields. Over here, you can see the plants ready for packaging. Then the top of the plants will be removed. A small movie, which is all done mechanically. And then afterwards, the plants get removed from the propagation field into the boxes. And then the plants will stay in storage rooms at -1 degree, and then will be transported to the fruit grower. Again. So some specific points of attention for raspberry cultivation growing. And then mainly the multiplication and the propagation of the new plants. It's important to use the good and controlled mother material because of the risk of crumbling, the risk of viruses, another important risk, the Phytophthora. That's all the reason why raspberry is at the moment mainly growing in substrate. Then there are specific variety, susceptibility to diseases, different kinds of attentions. The multiplication is all out of soil, and that's an important part to prevent different kinds of diseases. And another very important point is to start on time. Like I said, we start in December, also in greenhouses, to start up with stress-free young plants in the propagation fields outside. This all needs strict inspection requirements. In the Netherlands, it's done by the NAC Tuinbouw, and therefore you have a certification of identity and also the authenticity of the variety. It's all controlled by the NAC Tuinbouw, and it's very important to use the isolated mother material to prevent that problems like crumbly and other kinds, like I said before, will be disturbing all the plants with different kind of problems. So the plants need to be free of symptoms at the delivery and will be controlled at the propagator's sites. So that was the main part about the propagation of the raspberries. Then we will go on to starting a cultivation of raspberries. It's really important that you decide when you start up with a new cultivation to choose your harvest time, and then you can see at what time you need to start up the cultivation. And you have to make a decision if you would like to grow in a glasshouse or under rain covers outside. It's very important that the plants will be as much as is possible be mainly dry to prevent a lot of diseases which can influence the amount of yield you can achieve. So it's very important to start with healthy plant material from healthy and vital propagation from the right mother material. Besides that, it's very important that the plants, when they are in the storage room, are well cared and have the right circumstances in the storage rooms. In general, it's very important for raspberry cultivation that you do not ever use sulfur as a foliar application, because it reduces your yield with at least 1 or 2 kilograms per square meter. Never use sulfur in the substrate raspberry cultivation. Besides that, the water and feed schedule need to be in balance. I will come back on that later. And important is that two dry growing circumstances will bring misshaped fruits. So your water schedule and the balance for that need to be really perfect. And also another point of attention is the pollination with bees and bumblebees. I will come back to that also. So the production per hectare. I show you a figure from the cultivar Tulamine, and there you see different kind of yields, the production and the average fruit weight, where plants were getting this trial from different propagators, and you see the plant material from different propagators are quite different. So you need to be aware that your plant is in the best quality, and it's really not the same for every single propagator. So check your plants before you will start up a new cultivation. You can choose about different kinds of substrate possibilities. Coir, peat, perlite mix. There are different substrates on the market nowadays. Over here, also, I will show you a figure where we have done a trial with different kind of substrates, cocos, cocoa 15, chips, briquettes, different substrate combinations. And there we see have seen also different, that it depending the average fruit weight, which we have measured in this figure, but it's also influencing the complete yield. Then I will show you some differences about substrate cocoa peat in versus normal peat. It's all suitable for a multi-year use. It can be drier or more generative. More water supply is needed. And extra attention is needed for the starting phase. During night, the water supply may be required, but during night, it's really important that, because during the night, the plant it doesn't evaporate so much. So at that time, the water supply needs to be optimized to what the plant is needed at that moment. Then you have a risk of flush, potassium, barium, sodium, etc. You can see it. Also the buffering of the trace elements. The whole substrate of cocoa peat is very, it has another kind of growing possibilities. and the output of the water, it needs to be silicon free when it will be reused, when you reuse the water through the whole system. Preferably use rainwater and possibly add some spring water, and then it's mainly to buffer the pH, to add the right water quality to the substrate to optimize the growing. So the growing circumstances, to reuse the substrate, you really need to be aware of it if you really would like to reuse it, or if it should be better to start up with new substrate. If you reuse it, remove old crop as soon as possible and add new substrate together with the reused substrate. The drip system really needs to be cleaned very, that's important. And also the substrate must be keeping some moisture in it, and it must be flushed. If there were soil diseases present during the cultivation, then the advice should be that do not use the substrate again, or otherwise carry out a treatment, because there can be large problems by reusing the substrate. So for the growing circumstances, it's very important to use a special nitrogen fertilization scheme. And then the flower and the fruit development will be another scheme. The flower initiation, it's a very important moment. And you have to be aware what kind of things you can influence during the growing cultivation of raspberries. The canes, the branches, the leaves, the fruit, the leaves, the fruits, everything you can influence by different kind of fertilization. There are some differences. You have primocane varieties and also flowercane varieties. So just maybe to summarize it again, most of you will maybe already be aware of it. Floricane fruiting or summer bearing varieties are berries. Then with those varieties, the berries are grown in the second year. The summer raspberries need the cane that was grown a year earlier. And then on the fruits, they will be developed on the laterals, which were grown in the second year. When we have autumn or fall raspberries varieties, they produce in the first year. The plants grow and it will start up flowering in autumn and give the first spring production. Or the production in spring can be again. Everbearing varieties produce fruits on the floricanes in the summer and then produce fruits on the primocanes in the spring after. So just to be aware of it again. And I will give you some slides about different kind of growing possibilities which are there to use primocane. You can have year one. In the winter, you can prune it back, and in year two, in the second growing year, there will be start up a new cane growing and will be fruiting then again. Over here, another way, you have the plant grown at, for example, in the propagation, it will be stored during to achieve enough cold hours, and then afterwards, you will have new laterals for new fruit. And then the last possibility, you prune the plant, and then there will be two or three canes to achieve the new production. So then we go to planting density in general. In between the rows, at least 2-2.5 meters, otherwise need to be there, otherwise you don't have enough light to the bottom side of the plants. In general, we use about 3 or 4 plants per 1 meter, a maximum up to 16,000 plants per hectare. In general, that's the standard. We have also done some trials with Quanta, 4 to 5 canes per meter, gave the best fruits, with fruits which had on average 8.5 grams. You can also go up to 6 canes per square per meter, but then the fruit size will be lower as there will be less light available. So some examples of Floricane summer varieties: Tulamine, Violet, Glen Ample, some pictures of some Floricane varieties, also some Primacane varieties. Clearly, Quanta, Imara, I already told something about it. Some extra pictures of Imara, also a nice variety. Clearly, over here, it's also a productive one. Quanta with nice fruit, average fruit weights. Some French selections. I will not give all the names. Paris, Deauville. You can see there's also nice fruits. Some club varieties, Driscoll's, Maravilla and Rosadira. Ovation from plant size needs to be aware about double cropping. All different kind of varieties, they have their own special attentions. You have to be aware to grow them and cultivate them and achieve high yields. Choose the right variety. It's important to know who is your customer. And over here you see a blind variety judgment about the taste, but also the way the fruits were looking, in shape, in size, in firmness, in coloring, the taste, and in a global, in a general judgment. And then in this trial, you see Quanta was one of the most with the highest judgment about variety characteristics. So before you start up a new cultivation, be aware about the differences in taste and presentation of the fruits. Like I said before, flowering and the pollination is a very important part of the whole cultivation of raspberries. Honeybees are mainly focused on the nectar to collect the pollen, and has less contact with the stigma. Only this, honeybees are only active during daylight, sun and temperatures is influencing in, and it's visiting younger and older flowers. They are flying mainly only in one row and will not go into different kind of rows. They're mainly focused on one part of the orchard. And the last thing is that it's only visiting flowers easy and to see and visit it. If you compare it with the bumblebees, they are focused on collecting pollen, and therefore it has a good contact with stigma, and that's important for a good pollination of the fruits. There are more hours per day active. They start earlier in the morning, and in the evening they will go on for a longer time, and will also go on for pollination when the weather is a little bit bad. It appreciates mainly younger flowers, so not older flowers. So a combination of honeybees and bumblebees can also be a good solution. The positive thing of bumblebees is that they are flying around the whole orchard, and they also go more inside of the crop to find also and visit also the more difficult flowers. So a combination of honeybees and bumblebees, that's the best solution for a good pollination. picture of it, because bees are only also collecting the nectar, because if not the nectar is collected, then you have a risk that there will be some fungus on the growing on the nectar, which will be, which is be left on the fruits. When we are talking about the flowers, it's also very important, the flower initiation. The plants need to have strong flower buds to achieve a high yield. And a plant can only grow the developed flowers into fruits when they achieve the right nutrition and water supply during the cultivation in the propagation field, but also during the cultivation of the production. So the role of the water in the plant, it's a very important thing, because of the evaporation of the plants, the water transport, but also leaf cooling and fruit cooling during the cultivation. Opening the stomata depending on light and hormones in the guard cells, but also the amount of moisture in surrounding cells, ambient air, humidity, the CO2 content in the air. So that's important for greenhouses. You're able to change it, but also the amount of salts in the guard cells. I will explain it a little bit more. The evaporation, it's when stomata are not optimally opened, it results in not an optimal growth with non-evaporation plant parts. Evaporation means that the plant is cooling itself. The too high plant temperature is for sure a loss of energy through respiration, and a loss of energy means a loss of yield. The plants need to be optimum in evaporation. Absorption of CO2, the photosynthesis, it's there, you can see. It's a really important part of the plant to be active and to use the good energy to achieve the high growing circumstances you would like. So in practical terms, how do we stimulate the evaporation at the level of the stomata? Then it's important that there will be enough light. Like I said, the planting distance is an important part of that. The nutrient level in the leaf is very important, but also a sufficient water supply, and the relative humidity in the environment need to be optimized, not too high or too low, and it's depending of the circumstances through the season. Another important part is the root activity of the plants. The roots, like we said, saw already at the pictures at the beginning, the root system is really highly branched, especially in the first 25 centimeters around the plants. It's a small pot with optimal root system, and then 70% of the roots is present in that small part. And mainly because the plants are out of soil in those pots, those roots, they need to do everything, and the root activity need to be optimized. What's all determined by root activity? The substrate in the EC is important, the moisture of the substrate, the development of the roots, can they start up and growing, but also the substrate and root temperature, the evaporation level, and the radiation, so buildup of salts and sugars in the roots. Is it optimum? Is it in an optimum way organized? So, root pressure, more absorption of water or nutrients, then you achieve, instead of the evaporation, you achieve guttation. The nice, you can see it on the picture over there, then the guttation on the leaves is visible. Sharp transitions stimulate root pressure, evening and night positive, but also calcium distribution to non-evaporation plant parts is a part which is influenced by root pressure. And then you have a prevention of tip burn. Distribution of assimilates to plant parts without or little little assimilation, so the green leaves, is influencing this root pressure. So when root pressure is negative for a longer period of time, it can result in glassiness, so death of plant cells due a lack of oxygen and breeding the buds. And also brown flower stems or brown buds can be a result. Another risk is that you have too wet plants. Then there is a risk of root diseases like Rhizoctonia, Phytophthora pitium, Fusarium, etc. In combination with a lot of assimilates, a high sugar level, so brown and sticky fruits are at the plants. Those are not high class quality foods. Stimulating root pressure is a drop away from evaporation and to have a lower EC that is not building up too much salts and increase or maintain the moisture content of the substrate. It's important to measure the drain. The substrate and the root temperature is influencing the root pressure and also the radiation, the building up of salts and sugar in the roots. Stimulate evaporation is removal of moisture. That's an important factor you can influence to prevent too high root pressure. Increase the EC or a drier growing system is then you achieve a better plantation. Or otherwise reduce the substrate and the root temperature. Too low root activity. It's influencing, if you have a high degree of evaporation, the plant protects itself for drying out by closing the stomata. So the plant is not active at that moment. Less evaporation means a lower relative humidity around the leaves and then further closing the stomata. So the plant is not energetic, it's not growing, it's just standing over there. With the consequence that increasing in plant temperature and stagnation of growth processes, the plant is stressy and is not feeding its flowers or its fruits to achieve high quality. The roots need to be active to achieve an active and vital plant. Rising plant temperature is resulting in higher respiration but burning of sugars. The consequences then is smaller or no assimilate surplus. Then you achieve pink fruits, less production, everything, and also burning and combustion. When you have a situation of loss of water transport, less cell elongation will be there. Small leaves and fruit outgrowth, two small fruits, the assimilates and the food salt transport is not on an optimum way. The photosynthesis process, it is closing the stomata, lower absorption of CO2 and availability of water. And then the low root activity is also influencing a negative and not optimum growing system. If you have a situation of too low root activity and a low relative humidity, then you see, ensure that there will be plenty of evaporation crop. Habituation of the crop to evaporate it, the root activity, the EC reduction and the water, it's influencing it. You can also start up humidifying by, for example, roof sprinkling or optimizing the water supply. And climate control is very important if you grow raspberry cultivation in greenhouse, especially at the wind site, ventilation need to be started up to achieve an optimal relative humidity in the glasshouse. Humidity, what's then the optimum humidity you should achieve? In the growth phase, plants need about 75%. During flowering, a little bit lower, about 68 to 70%, and then at night about 85%, because of the root pressure. And it's not, it's you can see it, it's 85 up. What is the maximum? It's depending on the weather situation, the climate outside, everything, but the root pressure needs to be optimized. For the water supply, build up of watering according to the needs of the crop. The water supply is very important. And also around planting, when you start up a new cultivation, the substrate needs to be moist. But after planting, then also clean the plate, connecting the roots with the substrate, and substrate with extra moist so roots can start up growing into the other substrate around it. Here you see an example of the water quality which can be suitable for raspberry cultivation. An optimum DEC is very important, but also the nitrogen and also other the other elements which are important to start up with optimum raspberry growing. So the starting phase, then it's important to keep and moisten the entire substrate well moist, but not too moist. Start with water without nutrients, because normally in the substrate there are some nutrients available, and also from the propagation field there will be some nutrients available. And when the long canes start up growing, they at first they do need only a little bit of water. The nutrition to start when the rooting is over there, and you see with 1.0 or 1.2, the roots in the second half of the substrate, then you need some caution with water, because those new hair roots are very influencing by the water. So during the growth phase, when the plant started up, they're growing there, then you can build up a drop if EC to 1.5 or 1.6, and the drain EC the same. So if you count it together, the sum after dropping the drain, around 3.2. A drain percentage of 0 to 5% when a little crop activity is there. And afterwards, when the crop is more growing, you can start it up with till 10 or 15% with a lot of crop activity. Then you need to drain more to prevent that there will be root problems. There, the holes in the pots need to be big enough that there will be that it's possible to drain enough water through the pots. Then we go into the next phase, the flowering and fruiting phase. Then build up an EC even higher to 1.7, 1.8. And then the sum will be about 2.8 or 3 together. Then the drain percentage is also changing a little bit with a little crop activity. So at night, when the fruit, when the plants are not really active, the drain can be lower. And during day, when there will be a lot crop activity, that it will be about 25-30% drain, which you can achieve. Over here, an example of some water supply. You have to be aware that your water basin has enough capacity to give at the most at during the phase that the water supply needs to be at the maximum, that you have sufficient water available, and you can also change the volume of the pot. You can, for example, you use 1.8 or 2.4 liter pots, and then it's depending on the capacity of the water basin if you choose which water, which pots you can use. If you have 84 drippers a row and on average 12 water supplyings a day, 2 liter hours per dripper and 24 minutes per day water supplying of 2 minutes per supplying, you can see the amount of liters per water per dripper. And then a cultivation period, you see that 127 cultivation day in total, you give about 100 liter water per plant during the whole growing period. Need to be aware of that, that it's really taking a lot of water. Available for it. So another example, a crop with a full load at 30 degrees Celsius with a relative humidity of 50% and the wind is only 7 meters per square meter or per second, then the water requirements, including rain, is up to 8 liters per square meter per day. So your water basin has to be available for that. And if you your water supply is 250 milliliters per square meter per water supplying, and then it can be even up to 32 water supplyings. Well, it's depending on the circumstances. You will be aware of that. If the situation is that a lot of evaporation is there, then there is a lower need for nutrition. Otherwise, the accumulation of salts will be selective absorbing and the EC will be going too high. You need to be aware of that, that between 10 a.m. and 4 p.m. at the plant, the EC has to be reduced. And depending on the radiation in short supply lines, the EC needs to be measured during those periods. So the starting moments for water supply, substrate that is too wet during the night results into low oxygen level in the substrate, and then you will have problems with your roots, and your roots can be die, or you can result in root diseases. Crops with fruits must keep them under tension for maximum growth and to prevent crackings at the fruits. The fruits will be cracked when the moisture is not okay. So the growth and flowering phase drop until 1 or 2 hours before sunset and then quit, because then the plants will have enough. The evaporation will be lower during the night, and otherwise during the night will be the substrate too moisture. From white fruits, drip until after sun is going down. And check the amount of rain in the morning to determine whether the dripping has stopped in time. If there is in the morning still drainage, or the substrate is too wet during the morning, you have to stop earlier at the day before with your water supply. Over here, an example in which way you can measure the drain. You put some amount of pots on a shelter, and then you collect the drainage of the pots, and then you can measure really clear the amount of drain. So the drain control, then you control the EC and the pH, the control amount of the drain, in the amount of drain water, at least one drain collection per point per crane selection. You have different selections within your field. Make it, measure it at every single part of your company. The control moments for the drain need to be every day at the same time, and it's a gradient drain percentage during a day. It's an important part of your measurements and to control your crop. Humidification of all substrate units is very important that you use the drain, and also the nutrition concentration and the uniformity in the substrate. The flush of unwanted salts from the starting water. Too much drain causes drop in the oxygen content in the roots environment and settling of substrate. But not only drain is important. The watering amount, but also the amount of watering supplying, so the watering requirement. And that's depending on the phase of the cultivation, but also irradiation sum, so the climate in the environment. The wind, the humidity, but also the start and the stop times of the water supplyings. Substrate should not be dry out around the root tips. If it's getting too dry, then the vitality of the plant is not optimum. The insulation must have sufficient capacity and be reliable. At least 3 water supplyings per hour must be possible. That's a rate you can use when you start up. Over here, some nice pictures of plants and root system, which are very okay. But there are also examples which are not okay. Over here, you see 2 wet plants and substrate cultivation in the lower parts of the pots. And on the right picture, you can also see that on one part of the pot, only one part of the pot has sufficient roots. And on the other side, it's not enough. And then you will never achieve the high yields you will require. So here's some examples of some disease problems which can occur. You have, for example, Botrytis alternaria, all kinds of Fusarium, Phytophthora pitium, root fungus diseases will occur when the plant or the root or the pot is too wet, too watery, and the drain is not in a sufficient way. So water supply and nutrition, that's the main part you have to think about if you will grow raspberry in the substrate cultivation. Raspberry are preferably grown on a dry site, and this requires a rapid response in the cultivation. You have to be aware about the amount of water which is needed and which can be given. The good moisture balance is important for uniform growth, but especially in context also of late blight and other important disease. So control and on drain and pot weight, the drip lines, the homogeneous delivery of the water supply, but also the influence of nitrogen and nitrogen schedule weekly. It can be changed on weekly depending on what the plant is needed. And then you also can count the number of fruits per leaf to optimize your crop. You can choose for a mineral fertilizer or organic fertilizer. Mineral fertilizers have an even and constant composition per product, but any desired amount of plant nutrients can be applied at any time and any proportion. But it's hardly possible through an organic fertilizer. But nutrients from mineral fertilizer almost always work a little bit faster. They're easier available. The release pattern of nutrients from mineral fertilizer is known in advance. You can better find out and give it on an easier, better way. So the fertigation elements, we have the main macro elements and also some micro elements. And then you have a different kind of usage for the elements. It's passive or active. You have also antagonism, for example, the potassium and calcium, but also potassium and magnesium, etc. And then you have the mobile and immobile elements for the plant in their take up of their nutrition. So the main element is nitrogen and the function of nitrogen. It's structures of proteins, but it's also very important in the leaf green building, but also the building a block for genetic material. And it's very important for the vegetative growth. It's influencing the cell size and influences also the firmness of the fruits and the storability shelf life of the fruits. So the nitrogen, it's the very important has a very important function. If there is a lack of nitrogen, It inhibits cell division and plant development, and a light green crop and two less growth will be the result. So if the color of the crop is not okay, it can be a result of a lack of nitrogen. So the role of the other main elements, phosphorus is mainly important for the structure of the proteins. Potassium is mainly promotes cell tension and firmness of the plant. Magnesium is an ingredient also for leaf green, and it activates enzymes that convert nitrogen into proteins so that it will be available for the plant to take it up. The calcium is also important for the cell walls, and it's playing an important role in the various chemical processes in the plant, and also important for the firmness of the foods. And the last one, it's incorporation into proteins and amino acids, important role in the water management within the plant. The trace elements is also an important role, and it's important to have the complete nutrition schedule in balance for an optimal take-up. Barium is an important element for building block for cell division. It plays a role in water management and stimulates the flowering and fruit set. So during that phase, it needs to be available for the plant. Molybdene is important for the formation of the acemmalates. Mangan is a building block for enzymes that are necessary for photosynthesis, but also protein metabolism and cell division. Copper plays a role in fixing the nitrogen and calcium, but and also formation of green grains. Zinc is important for the enzymes in the leaf green granules, but it's also important for amino acids that produce alternate gibberellins. And the last one is building block for leaf green, building block for enzymes that play a role in plant respiration. A nitrogen supply, over here an example per minute, 2 liters per hour dripper, and then in 1 liter or in A or the B box within the schedule, then you see how much kilograms of nitrogen are available. If you then supply 2 liters per hour with a dripper, then you have 0.00056 kilogram N nitrogen supply per minute. So you have to be aware that every time the nitrogen supply needs to be there in the scale which the plant has needed. Over here, an example of a nutrition scheme for specific raspberry. The EC level, but also then it's an example of a nutrition scheme, which is depending on the water quality. So it's not that you can start up at every situation with this kind of scheme. Mostly two types of nutrient schemes are used during the cultivation, one for the start of the growth and one from flowering and during harvesting. And then among other things, the potassium is a little bit higher during flowering and harvesting. So you can to have it available in the fertigation scheme. Over here, a nutrition example with A and B tank for raspberry. With you see the calcium nitrate available, but also the potassium nitrate in the A part, and in the B tank, the other trace elements which are added over there. Some lag phenomena. If the leaves are yellow or the leaves have a normal are less than a normal growth when the leaves are too small, it can be a result of too low amount of nutrients available during the growth. when you have brown dead spots, it can be a result of different kind of nutritions. Sunburn is another part which can be a problem during the cultivation. It's not only the radiation. It's not only the temperature, but it's mainly often the radiation which influencing the sunburn on the flowers, like you see in the picture. The humidity under the covers has also an important role. So if you are able to change the humidity under the covers, then it's also and has an important role to prevent sunburning on the fruits. Then we go over to some pests and diseases which can be a problem in raspberry cultivation. The main fungal diseases: botrytis, mildew, rust, and the root dying, which I have already told before. I will show you some pictures of leaf and cane disease, cane spots, cane dying, twig disease, different kind of all fungal diseases which can occur. But by using rain covers and preventing that the plants are getting wet, then in general you prevent also the occur of this kind of diseases. And perhaps with only a few fungicide sprayings, you can prevent that these kinds of diseases will occur. Some pests over here, you see some problems due to lice and the result of sooty mold on leaves, but sometimes also on fruits, and at that time then fruits are not able to sell anymore, to be sold. So prevent that lice are in the cultivation, you have to be really early scout the plants on it. We also have some other insect problems which can occur: caterpillars, gall midges, and thrips. So it's important to scout in the plants and to react on it on time. Spider mites can also be a problem, or the ones on the picture on the right side. It's increasing, in our opinion. And then another important problem which can occur, the Drosophila Suzuki. It's a strong increase during the season. In our situation, when the first cherries are picked, then the Drosophila comes into the raspberries. So then you have to be aware of it. And in general, it's important to keep the environment tidy, short grass, no weeds, and a lot of hygiene around the plots are influencing the way you will have problems from Drosophila Suzuki, or it will be okay. So a summary of this whole raspberry cultivation in substrate. A summer raspberry, a minimum of approximately 25 or 30 tons per hectare can be reached, but a maximum is still not reached at the moment, and we think it can be even higher. So with an innovation like long cane primer canes, for example, maybe we can have to go up to 40 or 50 tons per hectare and have several cultivations per year. The fruit size, it should be nice to have at least 6 or up to 7, maybe 8, 9, 12 grams. It should be nice in coming future to optimize the fruit size. Important is to always start with young plants which are propagated from basic or controlled mother plants. Really, really important. For autumn raspberry, only 2 times harvest in a pot, but propagation long canes need to be done every year. So planning and choosing your plants, the varieties you can choose, the variety differences is important to important role in it. But and you can choose for autumn or summer varieties. To achieve high yields, it's important to plan your harvest time depending on what the market and the sales are asking in the different periods of the year. Long canes, you can change and you can choose your planting moment, and therefore you can plan your harvest time. So be aware and use it on the optimal way. The water supply, the nutrition schedules are very important, like I said in the whole presentation. You need to be aware of this with raspberry cultivation in pots. The crop protection is also an important part, but if you use rain covers, then it's in general the fungal diseases aren't a main problem like it is without rain covers. So that was the conclusion of my whole presentation. If you have any questions according to it, you can contact me on the email address which is mentioned. And I would like to thank you very much for your attention.